I think I bring added value to the school district from my perspective as a representative from Subdistrict 6, which is supposed to be represented by a minority. I am vocal, and I am concerned that we provide the best education and that we do the best we can do for our employees. Springfield is still a community education-wise in transition, I believe. I think that we have a ways to go before we get to where I think that we ought to be, and that would be that we provide access to all levels of education for all students.
And what do you see as the primary responsibility of being a District 186 school board member?
To oversee, we oversee curriculum, to oversee the budget, and to make sure that our facilities are well maintained, and to supervise the superintendent.
Facilities was certainly a bit of a topic for the district as of late with the open sessions that are going on. What are your priorities for the District 186 buildings?
Well, I would like to see us have some new facilities. It's an effort that will require input and support from the total community, not from just property owners, but there are residents and rental properties that should have some say, and that we get everybody's perspective, whether you have a child in the district, or whether you teach in the district, or whether you clean in the district, you're a parent in the district, the total community should have input.
Do you have specifics in mind when you say that we need some new facilities? Are there particular schools of concern to you?
No. I believe that our buildings are well maintained. But when you go out, and I'm a basketball fan, so when you go out into these rural communities, they have modern facilities classroom-wise, and they have modern gymnasiums and auditoriums. So I think we should keep up with the times. It took forever for District 186 to get toilet paper on a roll, and we just did that. So, you know, other communities have done that for a long time. But we went to Effingham, because I follow Lanphier High School, on Tuesday night, and their gymnasium was, it was gorgeous. It was 21 years old, but it looked practically brand new. Okay.
Finances, state budget impasse has affected more than just state agencies, school districts in particular. I know you're seeing late categorical payments. How has that affected the balance at District 186 between revenue and spending?
Well, I think that we are, my feeling is that we're in good shape financial-wise. We have some money in reserves, and it would be great if we could get our categoricals dollars that we're owed. It would help out a lot. When money is slow to come in, then you're slow to maybe give raises as maybe they should be. You don't want to discourage people from teaching by not being able to pay a decent wage.
Are there other strains on the budget, or it sounds like you think the district's doing okay?
Well, there's always a strain because, you know, education is like technology. It changes every day. And in order to keep up with the resources that you need to educate children, you need dollars to do that. And you need technology, you need materials to work with, and to provide opportunities for students to go out into the world and see what's going on outside the school building.
I was a little bit surprised, I think I've got this right, that there was only a one-year agreement reached with Springfield Education Association?
Right, because we've been doing that for last several years, and it's not something that I think board members are generally in favor of, but it's what the district dollars will allow us to do. When you're not getting your money in a timely basis, then it's hard to project what you're going to have.
And, so rather than a multi-year contract?
We've been doing one-year contracts for at least, I think, the last maybe, well, basically almost ever since I've been on the board, which is, I was a little girl when I started.
Also with finance, oh, go ahead.
No, I was just saying, I can only imagine the answer to this. They're, you know, talking about the freezes in property taxes, mm-hmm. the state house. You know, sometimes they're mm-hmm. talking temporary, sometimes they're talking permanent. Talk to us about how that would affect our schools.
Well, since we derive a reasonable portion of our monies from property taxes, it would slow down the progress of increasing wages. It would slow down the process of maybe making some improvements to the buildings that we do currently have. And it would have a great impact on our ability to maintain what we have now, I think. That's my personal opinion. And sure, property tax relief would be a great thing, but people still would like for their children and grandchildren and others to be educated, so we don't want to stop or impede the progress of education.
What's your greatest passion as being on the board? What really gets you going? What really excites you?
Fairness. I believe everybody should be treated fair, whether it's in the school district or in the community or wherever I am. I have a passion similar to Babs Dickerman, okay? People need to have fairness and access to things in their life. And if I have something that I can share with them, then I want to be able to do it. I believe that kids should get a good education. They should be accepted for their abilities, and they should be encouraged to do the best they possibly can do while they're under our care. And I don't always see that. I think that access to jobs in the school district should be based on your ability and your education, the job requirements, not on who you're related to, okay? So I think fairness is what I look for all the time. First thing.
That's how you measure everything.
Yeah, that's how I measure, yeah. When I hit the ground in the morning, that's, yeah, I want everybody to be fair.
You talked at the start about your concern about whether kids are getting equal access to educational opportunities, mm-hmm. no matter where they are. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit more about that in terms of where you see the problems are now and how the district administrators are doing, you know, trying to resolve it?
Okay. I think we've made some progress in terms of giving children access to the more challenging, the AP courses and those kind of things, but we still have a long way to go. If you looked at the numbers from the study that we just had done, you know, it's somewhere around 600, all right? I don't know the total number of kids in high school, but we have 15,000 students in the district. And I believe that every kid should be challenged, like I said, to the best of their ability. You know, they should be given that opportunity to take that class if they exhibit any abilities to do the hard stuff. I think when I came up, I was challenged. I believe truly I was challenged, but I was a good student, and I was in a community where people wanted us to really learn. I think that if we provide the proper training for our administrators, they will be able to seek out those students, encourage them to do the best they can do. And I believe that a student who is challenged is a student who's going to stay out of trouble.
What's the role of the earlier grades? And it sounds like you're saying, I don't want to put words in your mouth, that people have to identify students much earlier.
I think so. I think it starts in elementary school. In Springfield, they have a tendency to say that, you know, our elementary schools are great. They are good. But what are they teaching our kids about the value of life and respect? You know, I think if you instill some self-respect, if you show respect, you'll get respect. That's my persona. You know, show respect, you get respect. And I think we encourage good behaviors. We encourage kids to explore. Yeah. That's where you increase your STEM eligible students, you know, to challenge them in the areas of science and math and all those kind of things. Develop an interest. I think that maybe the curriculum across America has changed so much that it's maybe not as stimulating as it was when we were in school. I personally believe that a kid should be able to add, subtract, divide, multiply in their head, not use a computer or a calculator, right? It stimulates your brain to think about other things. Makes you want to think, well, how is that put together? Or how is that formula? It's like a recipe. If you read a recipe in a magazine, the ingredients sometimes will tell you whether you really want to be bothered with trying to stir it up and put it in the oven or not, you know?
Along those lines, what's your feeling about magnet programs and, you know, the charter school program?
I'm not against them. I think they do provide opportunities for some exceptional students, but I think then that's where you maybe lose some of the students who have the ability that just don't get that opportunity. I think when a teacher goes into a classroom of a morning, she goes in to teach the whole class, not the kid that's dressed well, not the kid that smells good, you know, not the kid that looks healthy like he's wide awake and all that. Sometimes you have to do an extra push on that kid, that because you don't know what went on at home the night before. And you have to take an interest. I believe teachers should take an interest in their students. You know, I'm not saying go home with them and bathe them and all that, but you need to have an interest to make them feel like they can come to you and tell you something.
How would you describe the level of engagement the community has with District 186?
I think it varies.
Okay.
I think it varies by topic. I think it, yeah, by day sometimes. I mean, I think that our communication has improved vastly, but and our doors are open. They seem to be more open than what they were when I first went on the board 15 years ago. People are feeling more welcome to come into buildings, more welcome to come in and volunteer. And so I think that our superintendent welcomes people. She is out in the building. She's out in the community. She's in different organizations. So that she's good. She's very good PR from District 186. And I think that board members as ambassadors, I think we do a good job. Currently we have a board that gels pretty well together. And I think that our ability to broadcast the board meetings creates some interest. I know people like to watch it because they want to know what I'm going to say. They tell me, I watch it because I just wanted to know what you were going to say. But yet and still, you know, it puts something in their mind that, you know, I'm going to turn on Channel 22, see what Judy's up to. So.
Well, there's been a lot of talk. The Chamber of Commerce was involved with studying the district. district did about people's perceptions of it, y'all, that with the progress that's been made, how do you build on that to continue to address, you know, any lingering perception problems with the district?
Well, I think if we can convince people to be a part of our right now ongoing facilities discussion, which is very open, I think that'll bring in a lot of people. I think that if we are able to improve our facilities, it will encourage the Chamber of Commerce to encourage the realtors to bring newcomers to the community in to view our properties so that their students can be a part of Springfield Public Schools. The rumor is that the realtors take people outside the district to encourage them to buy homes outside of Springfield, but, you know, people, I'm an HGTV fan, people like to be close to work, okay? And if we don't let this gracious governor of ours close down the state, I think we'll be doing a great job.
So with the ongoing facility study, how are you looking at that now? Are you, has there been a positive enough response to that in terms of attendance and kind of the plan they've laid out? What's your sense of that?
Okay, so it's a study in progress. We've done this at least, I'm thinking, three times since I've been on the board, and we always get to the phase where, you know, the recommendations are made, but then it just kind of dies down. So hopefully with this company that we're paying this money to, that we will be able to develop a true needs plan, which I believe we have done before, but they will work with us in order to get a positive perspective in the community so that when we have to pass a referendum, we can pass it and raise the funds that we need to raise. I mean, it's not going to be an immediate stopgap, but it's something that we need to do. We need to replace buildings that are 100 years old, no matter what. We've done a lot of asbestos removal. Every time you go in and do a project, then that's an extra cost because you've got to get that out before you can do anything to the floors or anything. So hopefully, as the school district and build work together on communications, we can make progress. And I've made a couple suggestions that I hope they'll take in terms of trying to reach out to different segments of the community. And I personally thought about it. How are we going to reach the people whose children are currently in kindergarten, but by the time they get to high school, how are we going to reach those people so that their children will have better facilities than what we have now?
My understanding, too, is that this is really a long-range plan, so that
yes,
they're not going to come back with something that says you need to do this next year, even though there may be bits of that, mm-hmm, but here's what you need to do over the next 10 years.
Yeah, it needs to be a time-lapse process. I mean, because like we replaced Enos and Matheny Withrow with health life safety dollars, okay? But that's, you can only replace square foot for square foot under that method. We need to sometimes expand our buildings. We might need to look at boundaries for schools. I'm sure we need to look at boundaries for schools. So those kind of things are play into the whole process.
How will you work to ensure compliance with the Open Meetings Act and Freedom of Information Act?
Oh, I'm on it all the time. I guess because of my experience in the legislature, gives me maybe just a little bit of an advantage over some of the other people around the table. So, you know, I know when a discussion should be held in executive session and when it should be held in open session. And a lot of times people say to me, well, why you do that? Well, I'll ask a question because I believe that if we've even broached it in executive session, we should broach it in public session, so people know what we're talking about. Not trying to give away the secrets in the exec session, but people need to know what kind of discussions you're having sometimes behind closed doors. Yeah. Especially if it affects them and their children.
Well, then we would just invite you to share with our readers anything else you'd want them to know about you and what makes you the best candidate for this position.
Well, I think my years of experience, I think that my vocalness, willing to speak up on issues, is an advantage. I don't believe sitting at the table and keeping my mouth shut is what the Lord wanted me to do when he put me in this position. And I think that if we all work together, I think we can continue to have a great public school system in Springfield.
Great.